Dr. K. S. Ramakrishnan is working as an assistant professor, School of Education, Tamil Nadu Open University, Chennai 15. He has been teaching science education, environmental science, educational technology, and research methodology in various colleges of education and Tamil Nadu Open University for the past 9 years. He has guided so many M.Ed., M.Phil., and Ph.D. students. His current research areas are environmental education, educational technology, and media and communication. He has conducted various workshops on ICT usage in education, Wiki Educator, e-content development, and educational research methodology. He had attended many online workshops on Moodle Learning Analytics. He has published 6 books and many articles in national and international journals of repute. He regularly gives plenary and keynote speeches on environment and ICT-related issues at various national and international conferences. He has delivered 28 episodes of the program Pudiyodor Ulagam at All India Radio, Chennai, related to various new developments in science and technology.
Welcome, audience. In the last episode, we had discussed about how the power generation is impacting the environment. We had discussed about how the fossil fuels and nuclear power generation impact the environment. In this episode, we are going to discuss further about how the various power production like nuclear power, wind power, hydroelectric power, geothermal energy, tidal energy, and solar energy, they are impacting the environment. Now let us start with the nuclear power. Tritium. The primary concern for tritium is the presence in drinking water. In addition to biological magnification leading to tritium in crops and animals consumed for food, tritium is an isotope of water, hydrogen, and it is the least dangerous radionuclide because it emits very weak radiation and leaves the body relatively quickly. And next, what are the risk of cancer due to radioactivity? The risk of cancer in both plant workers and the surrounding public have been caused accidental releases. Some workers in uranium mining also had elevated risks of cancer. So, it is understood that the radioactivity is causing cancer. But let us see the fact. Numerous studies of possible cancers caused by nuclear power plants in normal operation have come to opposing conclusion, but the research says on the other way. A study conducted by the British Committee on Medical Aspect of Radiation in the Environment, it has found that people living near nuclear power plant are no more likely to develop leukemia. Leukemia means blood cancer, than those living elsewhere. That means that the occurrence of leukemia in the people near the power plant is no less than or greater than that of the people elsewhere. And a similar study in the United States also confirmed it. So, by the studies, we are coming to an understanding that the nuclear power reactors are not as dangerous as any other power production agency. And what is the reason for it? You should look at the diagram. See, all the nuclear waste, they are packed in tight aluminium packages and they are buried under the earth some 30 or 40 meters deep into the earth. And therefore, the nuclear radiation, that is very less, which is emitting. And even the alpha, beta and gamma radiation coming from the nuclear waste, they are very, very minimal. And therefore, the nuclear power production is considered one of the safest production agency. And now, this is the picture of the Chernobyl. And whatever areas they are marked by red in color, they are confiscated or closed zone. And which are in orange, they are permanent control zone, they are under control. And the next one, light orange, that is periodic control, and the yellow color, that unnamed zone. and therefore here you see only in certain areas they are confiscated or they are totally closed, and all other areas they are open to the people. And therefore this is the cause, the cesium 133 contamination in Chernobyl as of 1996. And you can see that only in limited portion the cesium 137 radioactivity is beyond the expected or the points. And now let us start discuss about the wind power. The wind energy is another sort of power production agency, and in warm countries or hot countries like India, a large amount of wind power can be trapped. And there are two types of wind power, one is onshore and another is offshore. And the wind power that is harnessing the mechanical energy from the constant flow of air over the surface of earth. And the wind power stations, which generally consist of wind farms, fields of wind turbines in locations where the relatively high winds are occurring. And now let us discuss about the onshore wind. The modern large wind turbines, they have become commercially important energy source. A modern wind farm, when installed on agriculture land, has one of the lowest environmental impact of all energy resources. Now let us talk about the offshore wind. Offshore wind is somewhat similar to terrestrial wind technologies, as a large windmill like turbine is located in a fresh or salt water environment. The only difference is that it is offshore and that is onshore, and both are producing the similar kind of energy. And the wind causes the blade to rotate, and which is then turned into electricity and connected to the grid with the cables. So the cost of the production of electricity in most of the energy production agencies are somewhat similar. The turbine is rotated by some power, either it is wind power or steam or solar or whatever it may be. And the turbine is connected with electromagnetic rotor, and when that is rotating inside a magnetic field, that is producing the power. So it is the general power production according to Faraday's law of induction. And the advantages of offshore wind, the winds are very stronger and more consistent, allowing the turbines of much larger size to be erected by vessels. The disadvantages are the difficulties of placing a structure in a dynamic ocean environment. That is the only problem, because the ocean is constantly producing wave, and therefore it is a dynamic environment, and in that how to erect the structures, that is the only problem. But the advantages are much larger than the disadvantage, and therefore the offshore wind production, that is much better than the onshore production. See, now look at the diagram. These are all the onshore and offshore wind production. See, the wind turbines on an agricultural land, and here it is on the shore. And now what are the impact, how they are impacting the environment? See, it occupies less land area per kilowatt hour. See, look at the diagram, they are not occupying more area, and here the cultivation is happening. So it is in no way that disturbing the cultivation area. And now the energy conversion system, and is compatible with grazing and crops. So the crops are not at all disturbed, and grazing by cattles. Even it is told that the cattles are using the bottom or the pillar for their rubbing purpose also. And therefore it is more advantageous than any other source of energy. And it generates the energy used in its construction within just a month of operation. See, for example, the time of erection, and within 3 months that it is, the amount of energy produced is equal to, or it is more than the cost incurred in the erection of the windmills. Now what about the greenhouse gases? The greenhouse gas emissions and air pollution produced by the construction are very, very small. only one time that you are incoming, that you are incurring the greenhouse emissions, and there are no emissions or pollution produced by its operation. So during the operation it is not producing any pollutants, and therefore it is one of the safe resource. And the modern wind turbine rotates so slowly, and so it is not dangerous for the birds also. See, the annual bird mortality due to the wind turbine is estimated to be 0.02 millions or 0.269 fatalities per gigawatt hour, and therefore it is one of the lowest bird mortalities of all the energy production. See, even it is told that due to transport, around some 500 million or the 500 per million birds are dying because of the transport, but in comparison it is hardly 0.02, and therefore it is one of the lowest bird mortality. And now let us discuss about the hydroelectric power. Hydro means water. In what way that they are impacting the earth? The dams and reservoirs are used for supplying the drinking water, generate hydroelectric power, increasing the water supply for irrigation, and provide recreational opportunities and improve certain aspect of the environment. However, the adverse environmental and sociological impacts have been identified during and after many reservoir construction. See, you are seeing the two pictures. The first is the dam and the Wachsett Dam in Clinton, Mass, Massachusetts. And the second one, that is Lake Manantali of 477 km², it has displaced 12,000 people, and therefore there are some advantages and disadvantages also because of the hydroelectric power. And actually it is a rotor, and these are all the turbines, and when the turbines are rotated, here is a generator, and therefore when the rotor that is rotating in between the electromagnetic field, according to the Faraday's law of induction, electricity is produced. And so it is a common procedure of producing electricity of all the various type of energy production agencies. And there are small and micro hydroelectric power stations are also possible. In the picture that you are looking at two such electric power. The small hydro is the development of hydroelectric power on a very small scale, and it is serving a small community or an industrial plant. And see, in the first diagram, it is serving for a small community or a small village. See, the definition of a small hydro project varies, but a generating capacity is up to some 10 megawatts is generally accepted as the upper limit of what can be termed as a small hydro. And here is a pico. Hydroelectricity is in Cambodia, and the pico means it is able to serve for a small family or a small village, and therefore these are some sort of hydroelectric power station. And now let us see how they are impacting. A dam is acting as a barrier between the upstream and downstream, and therefore they are affecting the migratory river animals such as salmon and trout, and therefore it is a barrier for the free movement of the fishes. And the rivers are carrying some sediment down the river beds, and they allow the formation of depositional features, river deltas, alluvial fans, braided rivers, oxbow lakes, levees, and coastal shore. And all these are causing because of the sediment. The construction of a dam blocks the flow of sediment downstream, and therefore there is a erosion of the sedimentary deposition, and the increased sediment is built up in the reservoir. So on the one side the sediment is increasing, or on the other side there is no sediment at all, and therefore there is an imbalance between them, and so it is causing some problem in the environment. And the water of a deep reservoir in temperate climates, and they are stratifying with a large volume of cold oxygen poor water, and it is called hypolimnion. And at the bottom levels, the water is of devoid of oxygen. If this water is released to maintain the river flow, it can cause adverse impact on the downstream ecosystem, including the fish population, and therefore, as there is less oxygen, all the fish population, they suffer a lot, and this is another impact of the dam, the reservoir. In the last slide that we had discussed about the environmental impact of hydropower, and all the dams, they are resulting in reduced sediment load downstream, because in the upstream there is a overload and in downstream there is less deposition, and therefore the rate of erosion remains nearly constant, and the water flows erodes the river shores and river bed, threatening shoreline ecosystems, deepening the river bed and narrowing the river over time. And therefore, on one side there is no sediment, on the other side there is an overload of sediment, and therefore what is happening, the erosion rate is maintained constantly, and so in a long run the shoreline ecosystems are deeply affected and the river bed is deepened and the river is narrow over a time. Therefore, on the downstream the river is being deep and it is becoming narrow also. And now let us see what are the other impact. This leads to a compromised water table, reduced water levels, homogenization of the river flow, and thus reduced ecosystem variability, reduced support for wildlife, and reduced amount of sediment reaching the coastal plains and deltas, because all the sediments have been stayed over there, and therefore there is less the sediment in reaching the delta area. And the reservoir can become the breeding ground for disease vectors such as mosquitoes, which are vectors for malaria, and snails, which are vectors for cystomiasis. And this is another impact of the hydroelectric power stations, dams. Dams and the creation of reservoirs also require relocation of potentially large human population if they are constructed close to the residential areas. It affects the society in three ways: the economic disaster, the human trauma, and the social catastrophe. So, in that way also that is affecting the population, and so in all these ways, and sometimes the dams are occasionally break, causing catastrophic damage to communities downstream. Dams break due to engineering errors, attack or natural disaster. The greatest dam break happened in China, killing 2 lakh people, and this is also one environmental disaster. And the reservoirs may contribute to changes in the earth climate. Warm climate reservoirs generate methane, a greenhouse gas, when the reservoirs are stratified, in which the bottom layers are anoxic, lack of oxygen, leading to degeneration of biomass through anaerobic process. In some cases where the flooded basins are wide and biomass volumes are high, the amount of biomass converted to methane results in pollution potentials 3.5 times more than an oil powered power plant for the same generation capacity. And hydroelectric dams are the number one source of methane gas emissions caused by humans, and methane gas contributes much more to climate change than the carbon dioxide. And so far we had discussed about what are the pros and cons of the hydroelectric power. Now let us see about the geothermal. The geothermal is the heat of the earth which can be tapped to produce electricity in power plants. There are some differentials of heat in between the layers of earth. The warm water produced from geothermal sources can be used for industry, agriculture, bathing and cleansing. Where underground steam sources can be tapped, the steam is used to run a steam turbine, and the geothermal steam sources have a finite life as underground water is depleted. So, here the procedure is same for producing the electricity. And there are two types of geothermal: dry steam power plants. They are the simplest and oldest. They directly use the steam at 150 degrees centigrade for rotating the turbines. And the flash steam power turbines And here the procedure is more or less same, and actually the hot water that is taken to a tank, and from the tank it is rotating the turbine, and then the water is condensed and then it is taken to the cold side. And so in both the procedure is more or less same, but actually this kind of energy production is more common nowadays. And so the diagrams are explained. It is a hot one and it is the cold one. And the geothermal power plant does not burn any fuel. It still has emissions such as hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide and non-soluble minerals. They must be removed and disposed from the steam before it is used for generation. So, it is one disadvantage of using the geothermal power. Any closed cycle steam power plant requires cooling water for condensers. Diversion of cooling water from natural sources and its increased temperature when returned to streams or lakes may affect the local ecosystem. See, in the diagram you see the condensed water that is taken to lakes or some natural water sources, and therefore they are affecting the water ecosystem. Now, let us talk about the tidal energy. The tidal turbines, land constriction such as straits or inlets can create high velocities at specific sites, which can be captured with the use of turbines. These turbines can be horizontal, vertical, open or ducted, and are typically placed near the bottom of the water column. So, in that way the tidal energy is produced. And the tidal barrage, they are the dams built across the entrance to a bay or estuary that captures potential tidal energy with a turbine similar to conventional hydrokinetic dam. And the energy is collected while the height difference or on either side of the dam is greatest at low or high tide. The main environmental concern with the tidal energy is associated with the blade strike and entanglement of marine organisms. As the high speed water increases the risk of organisms being pushed near or through these devices. The creation of acoustic outputs may affect the marine organism. Depending on the frequency and the amplitude of the sound generated by the tidal energy, this acoustic output can have varying effects on the marine mammals, particularly those who echolocate to communicate and navigate in the marine environment, such as dolphin and whales. Because the dolphin and whale, they echolocate for their communication and for their navigation, and therefore the high amount of sound acoustic output produced may affect this organism. That is a disadvantage. And the tidal energy removal can also cause disrupting sediment processes, which may range from small traces of sediment built up near the tidal device to severely affecting near shore ecosystems and processes. And installing a barrage may change the shoreline within the bay or estuary, affecting a large ecosystem that depends on tidal flats. Inhibiting the flow of water in and out of the bay, there may also be less flushing of the bay or estuary, causing additional turbidity, suspended solids, and less salt water, and which may result in the death of fish that act as a vital food source to birds and animals. And therefore, sometimes what happens, the fishes may be trapped, and therefore the food chain that is affected. And the migrating fish may also be unable to access breeding stream and may attempt to pass through the turbine. The same acoustic concerns apply to tidal barrages, and decreasing shipping accessibility can become a socio-economic issue, though locks can be added to allow slow passage. However, the barrage may improve the local economy by increasing land access as a bridge, and the calm waters may also allow better recreation in the bay or the estuary. Now, the last, we will see the solar energy. and the solar energy is a conversion of sunlight into electricity by photovoltaics or indirectly using concentrated solar power CSP. The concentrated solar power systems use lenses or mirrors and tracking systems to focus a large area of sunlight into a small beam, and the photovoltaics convert light into electric current using the photovoltaic effect. And so it is a diagram, and here the converters, and they are focusing the sunlight, and here is a focal point, and therefore they are focusing the sunlight into a particular point, and therefore here the intensity is more. These are the reflector, and here is a focal point. And now it is a array of solar cells, and therefore a large amount of energy can be created by just stacking many solar cells side by side. And what are the demerits? The life cycle greenhouse gas emission of solar power are in the range of 22 to 42 gram per kilowatt hour, whereas a combined cycle gas fired power plant emits some 400 to 599 gram. These are all the greenhouse gases, and an oil power fired power plant 893 gram per kilowatt hour, and a coal fired power plant 915 to 994 gram per kilowatt hour, and therefore the solar power is very environment friendly. One disadvantage: the cadmium in its metallic form, it is a toxic substance, and that has a tendency to accumulate in ecological food chain. The amount of cadmium used in thin film photovoltaic module is relatively very small, 5 to 10 gram per meter square, and with proper emission control technique in place, the cadmium emission from module production can be almost zero. And now let us have a summary. In this episode, discusses the environmental impact of nuclear power, various types of wind power, hydroelectric power, geothermal energy, tidal energy, solar energy, and their impact on the environment. Now let us have some questions. Name the types of wind power generation. Second, wind power is the least hazardous to the bird population. How? How the geothermal power plants affect the environment? And the fourth, mention how fish population are affected by tidal energy, and why it is said that solar energy is the most environment friendly. Today we had discussed about various kinds of energy production and how they are impacting the environment. Thank you. Have a nice day.